Hello and welcome to the Healthy Planet, Healthy People session at the WHS at the World Health Summit. I'm happy to have so many people in the room. There are even some outside and even more people online. So I'd love everyone in this room to quickly make ourselves heard so people outside know that we are burning for Healthy Planet, Healthy People. Yes, I do own a jacket, but it's hot. The world is getting hotter. That's why I founded Scientists for Future. This is the climate stripes, the climate visuals. And I'm also founder of the Healthy Planet, Healthy People Foundation, Gesunde Erde, Gesunde Menschen. I studied medicine at the Charité, and now I'm happily ambassador for the World Health Summit to combine these ideas, because the crisis that we have cannot be solved on the individual level of the patient, but they have to be solved internationally and globally. So this is the focus on this session, that we want to talk about strategies to reach out to the media, to the politicians, to the change makers, because everyone that I've met so far at this conference is pretty much convinced already. But we're a very tiny little bubble that has really very little to do with the world outside at the moment. When you look at the news on your mobile in the meantime, I don't see One Health agenda popping up at the first priority. So there's a lot to do, and I'm happy that we do this with a great panel. But before I introduce our panelists, I would love to have a little video shown, because yeah, we need other ways of transporting the messages, and even more so with dynamic visuals, please.
Okay, this is really scary, but I feel like I have to document this.
Best whale. Okay, let's go.
I don't know how much more the city is going to be able to take.
This place is a piece of my soul.
We will never surrender to our fears.
Just a very brief look around the world, thanks to the Wellcome Trust who put together part of the footage. And it's important that when we talk about global crises, that we tell stories that touch people's hearts. And so I'm very happy to introduce a lady who touched my heart with her story when we met at Glasgow at the COP, because COP26 in Glasgow was, to my knowledge, one of the first where this connection between climate and health was really strongly put up front, and hopefully even more so in the next COP to come. But when you look at the burden of diseases, most of you in this room know this, but if you talk to other people, they're not aware of that. The killer number one is air pollution, 8 million premature deaths, which is an abstract digit, a number which doesn't raise any concern, until you find someone telling their personal story. And so I'd love to introduce to you Rosamund Adukisi-Debra, founder of the Ella Roberta Foundation, and she can tell her own story better than anyone else. Please come up, Rosamund. Thank you for being here, and thank you for sharing your story.
Thank you very much for having me. Before, can we start by playing the audio for me, please?
Can I get to this audio?
Yeah.
How does listening to that make you feel? Upset? Shocked? Uncomfortable? How does it make you feel when I tell you that this child is having an asthma attack? It is an asthma attack caused by air pollution of illegal levels, air pollution caused by the burning of fossil fuels, air pollution that is breathed by 99% of the global population. And as we have heard, it kills between 7 to 9 million people every single year. This figure won't come as a shock to you. So why do people continue to die? Air pollution that you could stop if only you wanted to. We are in the midst of a global health pandemic. We are in a public health crisis. And like the response to COVID, air pollution calls for world leaders to act now on a coordinated cross-border response to clean up the air we share. So why don't they? This is urgent. You can hear it in my voice. If countries around the world adopted WHO's global air quality guidelines, which were updated just a year ago, do you know 80% of those lives could actually be saved? So why don't they? Toxic air is everywhere. It's released from diesel and petrol vehicles, coal-fired powers, wildfires, wood, kerosene cooking stoves, waste incineration, and more. So we know the sources. Air pollution causes heart, lung disease, cancers, asthma, dementia, depression, premature births, low birth weight, miscarriages. I could go on. Children are the most vulnerable, with air pollution stunting the development of their lungs, hearts, and brains. We all know this. So why don't we do something about it? You and other world leaders must raise public awareness about the impact of air pollution on health. Government-backed health campaigns and communication about air quality levels need to be happening right now. Ask yourselves, why aren't they? The public need to know and understand the risk of air pollution, and doctors and nurses need to be telling their patients and help them to minimize their exposure to toxic air. The impact on our health from air pollution is well documented. There's over 70,000 studies. Cleaning up our air will reduce healthcare costs. Governments spend trillions, and yet it continues. But if you're not motivated by the health benefits of tackling air pollution, how about if I present to you the economic argument of cleaning up the air? Because whenever I speak to world leaders, they tell me, you don't need to make the health argument anymore. We've heard you. So now you need to make the economic argument. Can you believe it? According to the World Bank, the health damages linked to PM2.5 amounts to $8.1 trillion in 2019. That is 6.1% of global GDP. 6.1%. If I stood here now with a suitcase full of $8 trillion and I said to you, you can have this, have that money to spend on your healthcare systems, on education, on help to feed the millions of people now facing starvation around the world, what would you do with $8 million trillion? I am here to tell you it is possible. There is a solution to clean up the air we share. We need leaders to be bold. We need them to adopt the new WHO quality guidelines. You will save money, and most important to the likes of me, you will save lives. And on top of all of that, you will help your country keep its promise under the Paris Agreement to meet the climate change. This is my daughter, Ella. Her life could not be saved. She was 6 when she started coughing badly. In the end, she ended up with one of the worst cases of asthma ever recorded in the UK. She was born healthy, funny, clever, full of life. In the end, her journey ended up being a battle to breathe. In between having asthma attacks at home, I rushed her to hospital 28 times as the acute asthma took hold. She was admitted to intensive care 5 times and managed to battle back. She was resuscitated by myself and by the healthcare team on numerous occasions until finally she lost her battle in February 2013. She died just 3 weeks after her 9th birthday. It wasn't until the first inquest into her death that I learned of the possible link between air pollution and her illness. We live just 25 meters from the South Circular, which remains one of the busiest roads in the UK. On her final night, the air pollution, the spike, was one of the worst it has ever been. We now know during her lifetime, she lived with illegal levels of air pollution everywhere. The air surrounding our home was persistently far above the actual levels deemed safe by the WHO, and that was in 2005. The coroner was very clear to the UK government, unless you clean up the air, and this is to all governments, children like her will continue to die. Ella remains still the first person in the world to have air pollution listed as a cause of death on her certificate. Ask yourselves why, if 7 to 9 million people are dying every year. This February will mark 10 years since she passed. Think about the amount of children who have passed since. Back then, 10, 15 years ago, we didn't know about air pollution, or most of us normal people didn't. We didn't know its impact on climate change. We didn't know the devastating impacts it could have on our health. We know now, don't we? You know. We need all countries to adopt the new WHO air quality guidelines now. These guidelines, they are achievable. We know how to do this. All we need is the political will. We need governments to take action to clean up the air and save our children's lives. I know listening to that child gasping for life was difficult for some of you. Let's not let that child and millions of others suffer in vain. Every single minute, somewhere in the world, a child dies. Since I started speaking, 6 children have died. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Rosamund, for giving testimony of your own suffering in your family and, yeah, giving a story to 8 million people. And that was really moving. And I think it's so important to, when you think about why is after 50 years of Grenzen des Wachstums, the Club of Rome report, why is there still so little being done about all these health issues and fossil fuel industry issues? It's important to ask ourselves, what is the missing narrative? And we will later on discuss this with another expert from the UK, with Dr. Amira Savas from Climate Outreach. And before I introduce Amira, I would love to check if Johan Rockström is online. Johan, you can see us, you can hear us.
I can both see and
Johan Rockström is the director of the Potsdam Institute for Climate Impact Research. He's one of my personal heroes when it comes to communicating, because, for example, he took the time to collaborate with David Attenborough in a movie about one of his big research items, the planetary boundary concept, to make it accessible to millions of people on a platform that is not scientifically driven, but where you can reach real people. And so, Johan, before we listen to you, I would love to have a little glimpse of this Planetary Boundaries movie.
The science is clear and has been communicated for the past 30 years, and still we're not moving in the right direction. I don't get depressed. I get angry. What are the systems? The science is clear and has been communicated for the past 30 years, and still we're not moving in the right direction. I don't get depressed. I get angry. What are the systems that determine the state of the planet? This is about us. It is about our future.
All is not well with our planet.
As we increase our pressures on Earth, we are now crossing irreversible tipping points.
Nature is being degraded at a rate and a scale that is unprecedented.
When we emit CO2, about a third has ended up in the ocean.
There's no sign of any wildlife at all.
Based on the 7.5 million deaths, we have already crossed the boundary as far as aerosols are concerned.
As we manipulate the planet's climate, we're literally playing with fire.
Are we concerned about fighting the climate crisis?
The window is still open for us to have a future for humanity. We still have a chance. What we do between 2020 and 2030, it will be the decisive decade for humanity's future on Earth.
Human health, animal health, and environmental health, the three are so much linked.
We've covered the whole planet with knowledge. The future is not determined. The future is in our hands.
It's a remarkable time to be alive.
You may never look at the world in the same way again.
Breaking Boundaries, the Science of Our Planet. Thank you very much, Johan, for this great example of communication with real outreach. Can we have a big of a round of applause for Johan? I know you're very busy just facing the next COP. Why was it so important for you to take this step towards a very popular way of getting scientific knowledge across to mainstream media?
Yeah, thanks, Eckhart, and great to be with you. And in a way, I think Rosamund kind of captures it very well. It's based on deep frustration, actually. I mean, I think we have to admit, and then you and I have been discussing that several times, that science is sitting on so much evidence of catastrophic risks, but also of pathways towards a healthier, more secure, and more equitable and prosperous future. And we're still not reaching out. We're still not getting the big finance, the big decision making, the really, really decisive movements of citizens to start accelerating in line with the disaster pathway that science is showing that we're following. So to taking a step out of the comfort zone and going from communicating scientific papers, which is our core business, to also produce a documentary together with Sir David Attenborough was a very easy choice for me. It was really taking a step out of the comfort zone and trying to reach the brain and heart of much, much broader stakeholders. And I must admit, Eckhart, that despite the success with the Breaking Boundaries documentary, we're far, far away from communicating in the really effective way. I mean, I'd like to see us to take the next step. And you are one of the great inspirations there, because I think you put your finger on the fact that we need humor, we need deep emotions, and we need to reach the heart of people. And just to give you one statistic that I think we should carry with us, I mean, 7 to 8 million people dying prematurely because of air pollution every year, Rosamund's story. But we also show that 10 to 11 million people lose their lives prematurely each year because of unhealthy food. And we have all this scientific evidence that if we decarbonize and introduce healthy, sustainable food with solutions that we have, we can tick off both planetary boundaries, a stable Earth system, the climate crisis, and generate healthier life for a vast majority of people in the world. And 10, 11 million people per year, it's a faster rate of loss of people's life than the pandemic. So we're really talking about a global crisis, and the documentary was an attempt to try and reach much, much broader.
I could listen to you for much longer, but you're very polite to interrupt for another question. One of the reasons you know him personally, I love his TED Talk, is Per Espen Stoknes with a TED Talk, How to Transform Apocalypse Fatigue into Action on Global Warming. And then he does an interesting thought experiment of what does it do to us when we are overwhelmed by apocalyptic pictures. And he compares it to doom porn, where he says, when you're looking at two drastic pictures, I don't know about your experience, what does that do to your own arousal? But you become numb for many of the messages. And so what I like about your movie and the work of David Attenborough is that he combines science and getting the message across of the urgency together with the awe moment of acknowledging that the whole web of life, the beauty of nature is still there. And what is your experience when we last met in Potsdam? You showed me your recipe for banana ice cream because you said you're part of the Eat Lancet Commission. We're throwing away about a third of everything that we grow, which is a hugely undertold story as well in an era where we are having more people suffering from hunger than we had 10 years ago. So you said before you throw away banana, put it in the fridge, stir it up, and you have delicious ice cream. And I was very glad because it's one of the few recipes that I can remember because it only has one ingredient. But linking, if we just had a session with a part of the Club of Rome network, we had a session on how to use influencers, for example, on Instagram more. Because there are huge million follower stars who talk about nutrition and health and vegan food, but there are very little linking this to your issues of the Eat Lancet report or the Planetary Health Diet. What is your boldest idea? How can we change public opinion by even collaborating, not even with David Attenborough, but also with people who are, already have a big audience, but are not in in this conversation yet?
Yeah, no, bold ideas are really required. But let me start by just one reflection on Per Espen Stoknes and a person whom I work very closely with. I mean, I'm one of the co-authors of The Earth for All, the 50-year update of the Club of Rome's Limits to Growth report from 1972, where we are exploring the breakthrough pathways, the giant leap pathways that can take us to a safe and just future within the planetary boundaries of a stable and resilient Earth system. And we have very healthy debates, Per Espen and I, because I'm of the view that humanity needs to be informed by all the diagnostic of risk. You don't want to go to the doctor and be told that you have some quite gentle infection when in fact you're sitting with cancer. You want to have the full diagnostic, and that's what we scientists have a responsibility to communicate much, much more clearly and much, much more frequently and in a much, much more systemic, comprehensive way, that we're not only having a climate crisis, we have an ecological crisis. We're losing 70% of all mammals on Earth. We have 1 million of the 8 million known species of plants and animals being threatened by extinction. We have the sixth mass extinction on Earth. All this has to be communicated frequently and with high emphasis. And I, of course, agree with psychologists like Perespen that this leads potentially to vary, that you're hit deep in the stomach. And how we act on that varies between different human beings. I, for example, act with more adrenaline, not less adrenaline. But I'm of the view that we need to put this diagnostic very straightforward, much, much more frequently. Think of the pandemic. What did we do in the pandemic? I mean, we understood in a few months that we had a global crisis. We acted as a global community on this crisis. We shut down the world economy. We changed our behaviors fundamentally in a very short time period. In my home country in Sweden, every day at 2 o'clock p.m., there was a government press conference with the head of state, prime minister level, and scientists giving the diagnostic on the state of the pandemic. Every day, 2 o'clock p.m., talking only about negative things. Did that lead to people becoming completely passive? Oh, no. What it meant was that citizens across the entire world understood that we have a problem. And we have a real problem. And it's a problem that we have to act on all collectively now. So I think it's rather the other way around. We have to communicate the risks even more. However, we cannot isolate the risks on their own. We have to tell the story of the solutions as well. When you go to your doctor, and if you get a disastrous diagnostic of a life-threatening disease, you don't want to exit that door with no solution. You want to exit that door with a recipe towards a cure. And that, I think, is the magic now. Solving air pollution, solving food health, solving all the decarbonization pathways can be done. We have the solutions. They are scalable. They require the right policies, and we can actually do it. So I think it's a question of packaging this. How can we then go beyond the documentaries with Sir David Attenborough? Well, I think we need to simply go really bold here. I think we need to start recognizing that, you know, young people, people in general, they go to sports arenas, music arenas, culture events, where you have not 1,000 people, which is like the largest number of people I ever get at any lecture ever. They have 40,000 people, 50,000 people, 100,000 people. I think we need to scale up the engagement with people far outside of science to be able to have true impact.
Well, one of the exercises I did this morning, and I would love to do it quickly in this room because we have so much input from the front, but there are so many knowledgeable people in the room. The question is, who would be the most surprising person you could think of who has not talked about these crises but could do in front of an audience of 40,000 or even a couple of million people? So I want to have 30 seconds. You turn to the right, you turn to the left. Think of, without any planetary or mental boundaries, who is the person who would have a large impact who has not spoken up yet? Please, start now. And Johan, you can name a few too after we did the group exercise. I'm very happy that there are so many talkative people in the room. Raise your hand if you have a good example. And Sophie is coming to you from Gesunde Erde, Gesunde Menschen. One person you would love to see challenged.
Agreed on Cristiano Ronaldo. We thought that soccer players actually really have a great audience and they have some kind of a credibility which maybe a musician or somebody else might not have. But then Beyoncé was also mentioned. But yeah, I think we remain with Cristiano Ronaldo.
Okay, who else?
Well, it's interesting to see we also got to Ronaldo, but we had a trio. We wanted Ronaldo, Taylor Swift, and Trump together. That would be something. If we get that to the next World Health Summit, I'm sure that it will be more people listening to what we talk about.
Ronaldo, okay? Trump, who else?
Well, I still have come up with a political panel trio. Well, religious political. So Pope and the presidents of China and North Korea.
Okay.
Anyone else?
Come on. And then we talk about this with climate outreach.
How about Elon Musk? Mm-hmm. He's talking about occupy Mars. Why not save the planet first?
Yeah. Yeah.
I thought talk show hosts with big platforms like Oprah Winfrey and Ellen DeGeneres.
Mm-hmm. Okay, just to kick you off in the spirit, each person on this planet is linked with every other person only with six intermediates. That's the small world phenomenon. So if we all combine, there will be someone who knows Oprah Winfrey, Ellen DeGeneres, maybe Johan, you know the Pope, or at least you know John Schellhuber, who knows the Pope. So there's only 2 degrees separation. Just to give you an example of how we can think outside of our tiny bubbles and boxes, and I'm glad to have you on the discussion, but I would love to introduce Amira Savas, Director of Programs and Research, Climate Outreach, has done an excellent job, starting with George Marshall, I met at the climate conference 2 years ago, and he really inspired me to follow this path with the health narrative. And so Amira, please come up. We'd love to hear your point of view because you're such an expert on the communication psychology.
Thanks. Can I speak?
Yeah.
Can you hear me? I have some slides. So I will wait for them to come up. Maybe while I'm waiting for them, I can tell you a little bit about my story. So I used to be a climate social scientist, and I was working in some of the most affected countries in the world, Pakistan being the one that I spent the most time. I worked there for about 10 years. In fact, my PhD actually looked at the last floods in Pakistan, the mega floods, which displaced 20 million people. As many of you may be aware that there are current mega floods that have happened in Pakistan. So that might speak a little bit to why I sort of changed my career path, because I got to a point where I realized it's not the responsibility of the people on the front lines of this crisis to change. It's the responsibility of the people in the countries that have got us into this place. Europe, North America, Canada, Australia. Really, we need to mobilize people across these countries to do more. There isn't currently a mandate. There isn't a political mandate on decision makers, on business to do more. And the average person in these countries doesn't really know what to do. So I joined Climate Outreach, which is an organization which is staffed full of social scientists, psychologists, and communications experts. Most of us came from either academia or the climate space. Disenfranchised or frustrated or feeling like we've been talking about the same thing for a really long time, but it's not getting through. And also most of the people in these spaces don't really represent the average person. So even I am quite different to the average person. I come from a family of immigrants, poor working class immigrants from Ireland and Syria, and people like me and my family are not really part of the climate movement as much. I mean, more and more they are now, but in terms of those who get to speak on podiums like this, not much so. So I joined Climate Outreach, and yeah, I'm here to talk to you today about what health workers can do for climate action, which is actually quite a lot. You have much more power than you realize. And I hope by the end of this, you're with me, you feel motivated, and you understand what role you could play. Could I have the next slide, please? Or I can do it myself if someone tells me how. Thank you. So one of the things we do at Climate Outreach is we do studies, nationally representative studies in certain countries, where we talk to the public about how they feel about climate change, if they see themselves in the story of it, do they know what to do, what kind of messages make sense for them, and what kind of messages kind of push them away. And two of these key studies are here. One is Britain Talks Climate, the other is Germany Talks Climate, which we've just done this year. And I have to recognize our partners who've been absolutely critical in this. One of them is More in Common, the other one is Klimafakten in Germany. Over to the next slide, please. I think go back, please. One more. Thank you. So just as an example, what did we learn in the UK? So our partners, More in Common, developed a segmentation. So they've basically looked at the British public through research and segmented the British public seven times. And then we went and tested the British public. Oh, thank you so much. According to how they respond to climate messaging within these segments. So if I can just give an example of where the problem was, why it's the messages are not getting through. If you look at this wheel, you have seven groups of people, and only the yellow one, the progressive activists, were the ones who were being reached by the climate movement. That's not because the climate movement didn't want to be inclusive, but if most of the climate movement come from a group like that themselves, the way that they communicate isn't necessarily connecting with everyone else. And we learned through the Brexit vote that we need to understand and connect and engage with a wider group of people in society. So one of those groups there, the blue one, loyal nationals, 17% of the British population, most of those people identified as voting for Brexit. What is different about them to the progressive activists? Well, they feel they're not heard in the climate story. They don't feel that they trust big institutions. They just feel that they're not taken account of. Nobody listens to them. Nobody talks to them in language that makes sense for them. So yeah, we learned a lot through doing this research. And we now advise those who are trying to communicate about climate change how to adapt their messaging and narratives in ways which draws people in rather than pushes them away. One example that I can give is in the UK context, when we did this research initially in 2020, the term climate justice, which is very, very popular amongst NGOs working in this area. And I also worked on climate justice. It pains me to say that that didn't resonate as a concept with the majority of the British public. Those who knew what it was, the majority, they kind of made them step back away from climate. And though a lot of other people just had no idea what it really meant. So that's helpful for us to think about it. Next slide, please. Oh no, I have it now. Okay. We're learning as we go. Okay, so we did this research in Germany this year, and here is the segmentation again done by our partner organization, More in Common. And so they've basically found that there are six segments in Germany, and some of them map over onto the UK ones. So for example, the red bar, 19%, the biggest segment, the angry, is very similar to the one that I mentioned in the UK, the loyal nationals, the people who mostly identified as voting for Brexit. So we've got the open, we've got the involved, the established, the pragmatic, the disappointed, and the angry. And there's a lot that we can learn again about each of those. And so we did some research with them. All right, and what we learned is that there's a three-way division of German society at the moment. So you've got the social stabilizers, they're the groups that the involved and the established who have a general sense of trust in institutions, have stable relationships, they identify as progressive or center of the political spectrum. Then you have the social poles, so people who go to the extremes, left or right, and they're also quite loud about their perspectives. And then you have the invisible third, about 30%, who don't feel connected particularly. They sort of fly under the radar. In Germany, the majority of them don't vote. And also we learned that they tended to be younger or from a migrant background. So, you know, we can use this, these insights to start thinking about who we want to bring into the story. Young activist groups are already brought along the story of climate change. That's why they're taking action. We need to bring in the other people. Okay, so where's the health in all this? You're probably thinking she's gone on and on and on about this, these segments, but what is this to do with us? Well, climate outreach is not the first to find that health is a very, very critical sector when it comes to engaging people on climate change, and we definitely won't be the last. So the call to action that I'm bringing to you today is going to keep coming and it's going to come louder. So you may as well just listen to me now because it'll save you time and effort. So why are you important? Okay, so just as one example, in the UK population, about 83% express that they're really, really concerned about climate change, but only 10% know what to do about it. So we don't actually have a problem of concern. This is repeated in so many countries. We don't have a problem of concern. We have a problem of translating concern into action. And there hasn't been that much thought and work put into understanding what is it that helps people make that transition. All right, just again, another example from the German study this year. So we asked people in Germany to select three of the following characteristics that are part of a positive vision for you, for your future. And as you can see, every single one of the segments put good physical and mental health first. So good physical and mental health is a major priority for everybody, regardless of their political background, values, identity. The second most popular was climate-friendly way of life. So for half of the people, that was their second biggest priority. The other half wrote connectedness with other people. And for the angry group that I mentioned, a say in decisions that affect me. I think it makes sense why they would say that, because they feel disconnected. They don't feel represented. And when we explore this further, all of the types draw a very clear connection between climate action and the health of people and nature, even if they underestimate how severe climate change is going to be for health and nature and for society. They really draw those links very, very close. Okay, another question that was very insightful for us. We asked people to indicate whether they think that climate action would have a positive or a negative effect on different areas. And so it was on a Likert scale, 5 was very positive, 1 was very negative. And the top two are quite insightful. So people think that climate action will most positively impact, firstly, the health of plants, animals, and nature, which, as Johan was saying, we have a big crisis of biodiversity at the moment, which is deeply interlinked with the climate crisis as well. And secondly, will most positively impact the health of people. So people really see how climate change and health are interconnected. And we work with health professionals because time and time again, research shows us that you are probably the most consistent trusted messengers on climate. So research in the UK found that 96% of people really trust nurses to talk to them about an issue. Why? Because nurses are seen as people with good values. They're seen as, you know, this is how they're perceived, people with good values, with ethics, who care. So of course the messages coming from nurses are going to be important. They're going to mean something for us. Similarly, Ipsos Mori did a study this year, which looked at who are the biggest trusted messengers globally on climate change. Doctors came out top. So 64% of the people that they studied, and this was a representative sample, said that doctors were the most important. At 10% at the bottom was politicians. No surprises there. And around, I think it was 24% were civil servants. So you have massive power. And you also connect somehow with a health worker in their life. So just think about the potential there. But when we work with healthcare workers, recently we did a piece of work with paramedics. They were more worried about plastics than they were about the impact of health on of climate on health and the role that they could play in communicating this message and engaging people. And don't get me wrong, the health sector accounts for about 4.4% of the global emissions in the world. So if that were a country, I believe it would be about fifth or sixth. So the health sector does have to become more sustainable. But if we just think about it from this perspective, so 4.4%, yes. But even if we just think about individual action, household level emissions, which of course does need some systemic action behind it, don't get me wrong, but about 34 to 35% of global emissions come from the household in countries such as Germany, for example. So just imagine the power that we can have if we communicate effectively with people. But we need to empower you to be able to do this. We need to work together. And we know that it works. We know that healthcare workers are amazing messengers, and COVID is proof of that. So we did, you know, research during and after COVID, and we learned that people do understand, you know, after experiencing this major crisis, they do understand why climate change is another thing that we need to tackle. But they also, what we found quite interesting there was that some of the benefits that we're experiencing, and I'm not saying COVID wasn't, you know, isn't a massive crisis, of course it was and is, continues to be, but the enforcement of lockdowns led to people reevaluating elements of life. So this is what we're still seeing in research all the time. People are talking about being at home more, connecting more with their family, walking more, this really feeling the co-benefits of slowing down. And that's something that we're still in that window of opportunity and transformation to bring everyone along, regardless of their background, political identity, and geography. And so, you know, an example of a healthcare organization that could have a massive impact is the UK's National Health Service. Sorry, I keep giving examples from the UK. It's not because I think it's more relevant than anywhere else. It's just we have this work there. So it's the UK's largest employer, and it's one of the biggest employers in the world with around 1.5 million staff. So that's 1.5 million people connecting with people every single day in multiple ways. As I mentioned, it's seen by the UK public as having high ethics and integrity, and there's a lot of trust with the people who work there. So not only with the impact of, you know, training staff, working with staff on how they can be more sustainable in their own lives, be massive for them to go home and have conversations with people, there's a domino effect, but also everyone that they touch and speak to throughout their work. So, you know, I think I've said it a few times, but I do think we really need to start thinking about working together. And we're not only putting pressure on healthcare workers, that's not what I'm saying, but as our colleagues said earlier, we need a whole of society approach. We don't currently have that. So, you know, media is very important. A couple of weeks ago, I spoke to 34 broadcasters to talk about how they should be integrating this evidence into what they're doing on drama, on entertainment. It needs to be part of everyday life, but you have a critical role. So I hope that you feel that too. Thanks.
Yeah.
The one figure that I didn't know is that 10% are not in, only 10% of people know what to do about it. And there's still this BP footprint story out that they invented the individual carbon footprint to divert the attention away from the political solutions. So Johan, I would love to bring you into this again. When you were talking with people from Netflix, I mean, doing documentaries is one thing, but if you watch what is being watched at Netflix, the bigger impact would be to have a fictitious story, a series on a family that's driven apart because one is a climate denier and one is an activist, and they have to celebrate Christmas together, and one is vegan and the other one's a turkey. And so you have all the elements for comedy, for drama, and for a family story there. Did that ever occur to you that we should talk about even other formats with Netflix?
No, definitely. And I mean, as you know, there's a sequence here. I mean, we've been, you know, for decades, producing fantastic nature documentaries. I mean, Sir David Attenborough is kind of the big master behind these. They have become increasingly, you could argue, quite disconnected to the challenges we have, because they kind of jump from islands of beauty in an ocean of misery, which is why I would argue David Attenborough has kind of stepped up and to become basically an activist. And then comes the kind of documentaries that we did with The Breaking Boundaries, but it was followed up by the satiric Don't Look Up movie with Leonardo DiCaprio, which I think was really significant. I mean, it's a kind of a trilogy, which takes on a broader attempt of really punching in a unexpected way, and I would, my dream would be to engage in an action thriller where, instead of doing what we seem to do in every action thriller, is that we first destroy planet Earth and then we try to move to some other planet, and we have some hero story of establishing ourselves way away from planet Earth. I would like to have an action movie where we actually reconnect to the living biosphere and land safely on Earth, and not the day after tomorrow where everything goes wrong, but where we in fact are able to deviate from disaster and come back into a safe space. And I think there's room for that. Nobody has actually produced that science-grounded action thriller. To close this, just to say, Eckhart, I think what the scientific evidence offers is nothing less than a script for a James Bond-type action thriller.
I just read Stefan Ramsdorf's, another scientist at PIC, column at Spiegel Online, one of the big news providers in Germany. And he was counting the premature deaths from heat waves this summer. And it adds up to 100,000 people only this summer. If you look at the overmortality in July, you have 12% more people dying in July in Germany. And I think this is the material for a crime story, because I can share your level of frustration, Johan, that I feel, because when I try to get documentaries on climate and health in German public television, I always compete with people choosing to watch a crime story. And so I thought, well, why don't we talk about the crime behind the climate crisis? Who are the enemies? Who are the villains? Who are the people who, despite better evidence, try to stop the transformation? And one good example of this, but as a documentary, not as a thriller or a crime story, is Merchants of Doubt by Naomi Oreske, who points out how this false balance phenomenon is voluntarily placed from false experts in talk shows and stuff. So this idea of really showing people who is, who's the bad guys in this story, this is missing as well as a narrative. Not only the positive co-benefits that Maria Neira, you're here, we just had this in the session before, and we talked about this in Glasgow, Johan and Rosamund tells her story, but actually there are some people who are more responsible than others for killing humanity. So I'd love to have your opinion, the two ladies here up front in the on the panel. Do you think that this approach of this very old dramatic figure of good and bad, and who are the people fighting for the light and who are the dark forces, has that been really told?
You go first.
I think as we are in a room of people from health, I think the first thing I want to say is my enormous respect for doctors. But I think I'd like to go back to my daughter's inquest. And one of the main things that came out of it was that people in health need to be educated. I'm not really into this divisive politics, good and bad. That's not really the way I do things, because I want to get everyone together. But my message to people in health will be the same way they tackled the tobacco. I see air pollution in a very similar light. You know, it's the biggest environmental disaster of our time. However, my daughter was under, and this isn't to blame, people know I talk about this very openly, all the hospitals she visited, air pollution was never on the agenda. And my message to doctors is, we've started it in the UK. Our CMO, hopefully very soon, I think people in the room are aware of what's going on in the UK, but hopefully he will be able to release his annual report, which is going to be about the impact of air pollution on health. And for people in health who are not educated on this, my plea, I am always begging, doctors are used to me begging, if I'm not begging to save my child's life, then I'm begging for them to get educated, is to get educated and pass this information onto their patients. I'm not really about good and bad, and it doesn't really get us anywhere, really. When people say to me, of course I am aware what goes on, you know, fossil fuels, money, what can we, you know, individually, we don't feel we can do a lot about it. But, you know, as you showed, people trust their people in health. So you have a very, very powerful voice. And the same way that doctors and people in health in the UK have agreed to get educated, I would like that the world over. I was coming on the plane and some, you know, the lady which I sat next to, she said to me, ultimately, if you had your dream, what would it be? And it would be as simple as this, to make clean air an actual human right. And I will be meeting up with you, which I have said, because I have to speak to all those groups that she mentioned there. And my thing is persuading people, you know, wagging, you know, your finger and saying you are wrong, you are this, doesn't get people anywhere. And we have, you know, being from the UK, I can see how divisive, because you mentioned Brexit. So I personally I really don't have time for that. My thing is about persuading people, giving them, you know, before I came on this journey, I was a teacher, so I believe in educating and explaining to people, you know, air pollution is invisible. So it is a hard task saying to people, at least with water, they can see dirty water, but they can't see dirty air. But I say to people, go back to during the pandemic, and everyone the world over, didn't they? They knew what clean air was. And I say to people, check out around the world, areas of high air pollution had more COVID deaths. Then people say to me, so why aren't the governments doing anything about air pollution then? So the cynicism in me says, well, coronavirus shut down economies and air pollution doesn't. And that's why they continue. But a lot of it, as we know, is about fossil fuel and money, but we can't give up. You know, we have a whole generation of young people, and it is wrong for people to be dying prematurely, or children like my daughter to be dying, but we need to do more. And you are so powerful as doctors, people listen to you. So if you're not on board yet, kindly get we can't keep on sitting here year after year and say 7 to 9 million people die. I mean, really, we're going to have to do something. But do we all breathe the same air? We don't. Those who are marginalized, those who are poorer, they are most at risk. So we have to address, and hence the environmental justice, what you're talking about. But it is the way we get the messages across. Doing that divided and blame is not going to get us very far, as we all know. We need to get, I don't think we're ever going to persuade everybody, no, but we need to get the majority on board. And we do need to put pressure on governments. The political will is not there. It really isn't. And that's my question to governments. You know about the people dying. What are you doing? What are you doing about it? We come to these things, we talk about it, but where is the action? There you are. Over to you.
Well, one paper I liked on the climate outreach homepage was how to connect the COVID-19 crisis to other topics. And this is something that I would love to invite the creativity in the room as well, because at the moment, as I said in the introduction, it's very hard not to feel frustrated because many things that have been already agreed on, like fusing out coal, getting rid of nuclear energy, at the moment we have a kind of rollback where people say, you see, the renewables are not doing sufficient service, so we have to go back to the world we wanted to leave. And I'm surprised that this health argument doesn't really enter into the renewable discussion. I mean, it's so obvious. If you have a choice, where would you rather be if something goes wrong? But near to a nuclear plant or near a rotor of a windmill? So it's so obvious that one technique is killing thousands of people and the other doesn't. And still we frame the whole renewable discussion always as something for engineers and not for health workers. So why don't we speak up? Because in one of the stories that I really love about health professionals, let's not forget about the nurses and firemen. Mm-hmm. There's a famous story of Scott Morrison, the Prime Minister of Australia, who in the middle of a burning forest wanted to have a picture of him shaking hands with the fireman. And the fireman refused the handshake and said, "Prime Minister, you will not find a climate skeptic at the end of a Schlauch, or you say, tube, hose." And this really went viral. And I think these are the little snippets that can work on social media as well, where you have people speaking up who are at the midst of fighting the pandemic or fighting air pollution or fighting a wildfire that is not natural, but is caused by the drought and by climate change. So this is the stretch that we have to do, telling personal stories and showing the big picture that this story is illustrating and not being left at the individual level. One of you mentioned soccer stars. One of the projects that I'm trying to push behind the scenes is making the next European Championship in Germany become climate neutral. So if we think of a team of France, or maybe England, not flying into the country, but coming by train, that would be a huge signal to the whole world of soccer fans. And if you buy not a currywurst in the stadium, but something healthy, some vegetarian food. And if a soccer star, be it Ronaldo or someone else, takes the analogy with the lion is the king of the animal kingdom. But what does a lion do? He sits around most of the day in the shade. Why does he do it? Does he do it on a voluntary basis? No, he's forced to, because the moment a lion starts to get the antelope and fails, his muscles produce so much energy that he's in a critical state for his own circular system. And if he doesn't cool down for the rest of the day, he's going to collapse and have a heart attack. And that's the same picture, the same metaphor applies for every physical active person, be it someone in agriculture, be it a woman caring for a family at the crop and in a hot countryside, be it someone working on the roof, be it someone running for his life or a million within a stadium. So why don't these people who depend on their physical ability to get rid of the heat speak up about the climate crisis? So there are many personal stories that are still to be told by prominent figures who would convert the idea that this is not a story of some leftist, greenish, hysterical people. And Johan, I would love to congratulate you on one of your latest publications where you said climate scientists have been too modest to communicate the risks because you were always shy, so to speak, not to be told to be overdramatic. And one of the latest publications of you was, how can we prepare for the not so unlikely scenarios leading us into a hothouse? And what was your response on this paper? What did you move by this?
Yeah, so I mean, to begin with, this is something that concerns many climate scientists today, that we have in the climate science community and also in climate policy focused all our attention on 1.5 degrees Celsius, which I strongly support, of course. It is a planetary boundary. We have just 1 month ago published a big paper in Science showing that past 1.5 degrees Celsius and we likely cross tipping points in both the Greenland ice sheet, the West Antarctic ice sheet, the tropical coral reef systems, and abrupt thawing of permafrost. So it's really serious. There's no doubt about that. But at the same time, all focus being on staying below 2 or 1.5 in the global carbon budget, and you know the discussions on cutting emissions by half by 2030 with a net zero world economy by 2050. That is assuming average outcomes. It's like assuming no tipping points, the Earth system remains stable, the oceans continue absorbing 25% of carbon dioxide, intact nature continues providing us with this incredible free subsidy to the world economy by absorbing another 25%. And we're seeing more and more signs coming out showing cracks in this system. So the Amazon rainforest, the Brazilian part, is no longer a carbon sink. Can you imagine? The world's richest terrestrial ecosystem on land, a massive ecosystem function for the stability of the entire planet, is no longer being our friend. It's actually self-amplifying warming. This is not very well understood, that we have unmanageable outcomes that can occur much, much earlier than we had predicted. So while the 50% probability pathway is that 400 billion tons of carbon dioxide is the remaining carbon budget for an average pathway that can take us and hold the well below two pathway, the same trajectory may have a 1-2% risk of actually creating self-amplifying warming that could take us well beyond 2 degrees Celsius, potentially even take us to 3 degrees Celsius, which would be a well-established, unequivocally proven disaster zone. And when you think of it, 1-2% risk for a catastrophe is a massive probability. When you step onto an aircraft, the risk of crashing, which is another catastrophic outcome, is at 0.001%. I mean, it's like a fraction of the risks that we are willing to take with climate change. So we're calling upon the scientific community to actually explore more the precision on catastrophic outcomes. And this is one of them being the hothouse Earth outcome, which is an outcome which means that planet Earth starts taking over the amplification of warming and where we lose control. Now, we're not saying that we are heading in that disastrous direction. We're just saying we need to stay away. We need to take the science seriously. And I fully agree, just to connect this with Amira's fantastic summary of the German assessment earlier, this is something that is quite extraordinary, that 83% of citizens in Germany are well aware of the problem of climate change. This is the same levels which we find in essentially all countries in the world, even in the US. Roughly 60% of US citizens are deeply concerned about climate action, climate science, climate risk, and they want climate action. The problem is they don't take it seriously enough. That's the trick. They don't recognize that this is the moment where you simply have to step up and really, really engage and solve the problem. And I think that is what science increasingly is showing, that we're running out of time to have this feel good type transition. We need to now have a much larger, broad societal engagement. Now, just to close this by saying that, on the other hand, what is quite fantastic, but also really frustrating, is that we have so much evidence that the pathway towards a safe landing on climate gives better outcomes. I mean, we've talked about that throughout this entire session. Health, security, jobs, economy, peace, less migration, less armed conflicts. So it's like a double mistake we're doing. We are having catastrophic risks, yes, but also if we invest in solving them, we can actually be winners on the other side. That story needs to be told.
And when I was moderating the K3, K3 Climate Communication Congress in Zurich a couple of weeks ago, I heard a great presentation of Fritz Reusig, a sociologist from the PIC. And he said that the counter narrative is winning momentum as well. The right-wing parties who are arguing that climate change is just an elite problem from people who have nothing to do with the real people and the hardworking little man and stuff, and that the amount of people who are convinced that there's man-made climate change is constant. But the amount of people who are really strongly convinced that this is all fake is also threatening. And we're losing democratic institutions. We're losing money for multilaterals. So we are at the moment, due to the war, also in a war of disinformation and a lot of people who are interested in destroying the path we've just started to take. So I would love to have your opinion on this. How can we put, in times of the media being full of war scenarios, still emphasize that there is still a war against our living conditions that has been worsened by the war with Russia and Ukraine, not knowing where this is going to lead us, but people are so frightened that at the moment you don't want to come. Oh, there's another catastrophe that I want to mention. Amira, what would be a good example, like you did with the COVID? Is there a way of productively connecting to the narratives with the actual media coverage of the war?
Thanks. Good, very good question. Trying to piece it together in my mind right now, but probably, I mean, let me just start with the misinformation piece. So in the UK right now, we have a major energy crisis. I know that's touching other countries, but in the UK, it's particularly bad. And when we look at the evidence as to why, that is because we never thought about the cost of inaction on climate change. We always talk about the cost of action, and we never talk about the cost of inaction. Then when the energy crisis really started to amplify in the context of the war, we weren't ready. The climate community, climate scientists, the media were not ready to have those conversations with normal, everyday people who are worried. This is the problem. There are not many organizations like ours that are doing this work right now. And so what we need to do is we need to empower a wide variety of people in society to be able to have those conversations when they happen and say, no, Dad, what's actually happened here is this. Or when they're talking to, you know, often like if I I'm chatting to somebody who may be a climate skeptic, I make it my mission to really listen to them, understand what is it that they're afraid of, and then offer gently and respectfully what the evidence says, and people will receive that. But we often don't do that. We don't treat people who are anxious with the respect that they deserve in these conversations. We kind of treat them like a nuisance. So I think, you know, firstly, we need to be better prepared. We actually need to understand that the climate crisis, yes, it is absolutely a crisis of mega proportions physically, materially, economically, but it's also a communications crisis. We need to be ready. We need to have the messages and the information, and we need to be able to talk to people in our everyday lives about it. So the reason why I talk a lot about diversity and inclusion and my background is because the large majority of people who talk about it don't come from a background like mine. In fact, I feel excluded in a lot of climate spaces, in a lot of policy spaces. And when I raise the issue of diversity and inclusion, I get people rolling their eyes at me like, oh, there she goes again, talking about diversity, talking about working class people. But this is the problem, that most of the people who are talking about this don't know how to talk to the average person. So we need to arm ourselves. We need to have communication strategies, and we need to also humble ourselves in our approach, really empathize with why people think differently and help them to figure out and see themselves in the climate story. And if we do that, I feel quite confident that those kind of moments of misinformation will be much more difficult to take hold.
I want to open the discussion to everyone in the room who has an urgent question, who has something that should be heard. There's a microphone. Dona, kannst du helfen?
Okay, so, thank you very much for this panel. I'm Billine Dohan from the University of Paris-Saclay, and I'm part of the UGLO Alliance, which is gathering nine universities. I'm very moving with the story. We are training a total of 300 and 1000 of students. And I have a question. Do you think that one action could be to, for example, organizing a football match with Cristiano Ronaldo in order to make all the students participating with an introduction, with this sort of video and testimonies? I do that because you said about the butterfly effects. And I think that if we are able to sensibilize all of these 300 hundreds of thousands of people, because they are learning, because they represent the young future, and because they are well educated, they can propagate these ideas. They have all consciousness of this. So I think that we train them technical things, knowledge, rationality, but not enough the transversal skills and the hurt. So I think that the future is on the hand of what you said, the future is in your hands, but the future is in your hearts too. So we have to work with the heart of these people, these students, to make move a lot of things. Thank you.
I'd love to collect some perspective, sure. And then we come back to the finishing round on the panel.
Yes, thank you very much for very interesting presentations. Amira, I was also very struck by your presentation of these segments of the societies, and I was wondering, we're talking about the loyalist nationals in the UK, and I think we have a very similar segment here in Germany, mm-hmm. who are now out on the streets every Monday evening. And I was just wondering, you know, what do you tell them? What's the arguments? How do you reach them? Mm-hmm. I thought that what you just said was very interesting, that you're trying to find ways to engage them with respect, because mm-hmm. I totally agree. I think that's a group which feels not heard and excluded. But I would like to find out more. Are you already trying that out? Mm-hmm. You know, how do you do that? Can one read about that somewhere? Thank you.
Me? Yeah. Okay. Thank you. On the communications piece, I wondered, particularly in a UK context, what your view is of organizations like Extinction Rebellion, or I know we've had stuff in recent days about, is it called Stop Oil, but throwing the stuff on paintings. Do you think it helps because it gets it up the agenda, or do you think it hinders because ordinary people go, that just looks a bit odd and I'd rather not be part of it? Where do you think help or hindrance?
Okay, good
question. Yeah,
interesting question.
Hi there. I just want to touch on a few things that you have individually mentioned. So Eka, you said we can change public opinion by collaborating with people who have a big audience but are not part of the conversation yet. And Amira, you also talked about the statistics that 80% of people are concerned, but only 10 people uh-huh. know what to do about it. So if we talk about bridging that gap in healthcare, I mean, on social media, you do have a lot of healthcare influencers, mm-hmm. practicing doctors who have a big platform, but are not actively engaging in the conversation of the link between climate change and health.
Yep.
So my question is, how do we even educate the educators, right? Would you consider having workshops where you train doctors on how to communicate this? And I'm one of those doctors in the platform where I'm a medic and I have a big social media presence. And okay. I've been fortunate to be invited in all of these spaces, but I'm still lost for how to really translate that through storytelling, because at the end of the day, nobody wants to hear all of the 1.5 degrees temperature that needs to come down. And you need to connect through storytelling. So my question is really, would you consider having those workshops where you have healthcare yes. professionals? Yeah. Okay.
The answer is yes.
Hello, my name is Bronwyn King. I'm from Australia, and I want to apologise about our former Prime Minister saying some pretty crazy stuff about coal. And we have a new government now, so let's hope that we, brighter days are ahead. First of all, I just want to say to Rosamund, lots of love and hugs from on behalf of everyone in the audience for sharing your story. It's really deeply touching, and it must be unbearably hard to tell that over and over, but just congratulations and thank you for doing that on behalf of everybody. And when it comes to clean air, mm-hmm. I really do wonder if we're at a tipping point, because 5 days ago at the White House, they had a summit on clean indoor air to reduce the risk of COVID, particularly with schools and businesses. Everybody wants to have a normal life, but if we don't have clean air, are we just guaranteeing reinfection with COVID over and over again? So if we're going to have a summit on clean indoor air, why don't we just have a summit on clean air?
Okay.
There's no point making, ventilation and having lovely air from the outside come in if it's just diesel fumes from the cars going by. So I just wonder if we're at a tipping point when it comes to clean air. You mentioned you wish that clean air was a human right. I swear I read about a week ago that it is. Maybe Maria or other WHO. Isn't it a right?
A healthy environment.
It's a healthy environment, not...
Yes.
Few weeks ago, the right to a healthy environment.
Right, right. Okay, so we're on our way, which is fantastic, and hopefully we can use that a lot. And globally. Yeah. And
that changes everything.
It changes everything. We have a platform. Exactly. We have a platform. It's already there. I remember I tweeted it to somebody, and I was just busy looking. I couldn't find it, but I knew I did it. And Eckhart, you were saying that you wished that the health argument would resonate. And, Rosamund, isn't it enough that 7 to 9 million people are dying a year? Isn't that enough? Now, I work in tobacco control. Isn't it enough that we use 8 million as the figure? Same thing, right? Isn't it enough? Now, I work with the big pension plans, banks and insurers, and I ask them to dump tobacco. And would you believe, just to share this information because it might be helpful, they don't dump tobacco because of the health impact. It does not resonate. I've been doing it for 12 years. I give the stats. Nobody even flinches. No one moves. I say 8 million deaths. But do you know what I've been doing recently in the last year since COP26? I tell them that cigarette filters are the number one ocean plastic. And you know what? They all say, pardon? Sorry, what did you say? Number one? Oh, but we have to clean the ocean. And I'm like, okay, then. All right, we've got to clean the ocean. And then I tell them that big tobacco has the same carbon footprint as Peru, the same carbon footprint as Israel. I tell them that it's 5% of global deforestation, just big tobacco. And now they're going tobacco free. They're rejecting tobacco because of environmental reasons. So it's a funny world. We're all a little bit crazy in what resonates and what doesn't. But I just thought that might be some helpful insights.
Thank you. That was really helpful. Thank you. Two more.
Hi, thank you. So Amira, I'm from Pakistan, actually, something place you have a lot of experience with. So my question really is the current situation with the flooding that we're having, and we have this on a daily basis, and I know on a routine basis, actually, almost yearly. And yes, the government is to blame because we're not taking enough steps to mitigate that, but like you mentioned, and it's mainly other countries that are generating these fossil fuels, big countries like the US and the developing world, does not have the same carbon footprint. So for citizens in my country, the people, global warming, climate change is not a concern. Mm-hmm. They want food, they want water, they want shelter. My question really is now, how do I communicate with them that climate change is important when they're not really generating that much gases? And if I do, how do I say it in a way that they understand that, yes, it is very important because right now it's not in their priority or their concern? Thank you.
Thank you very much to all the panelists and speakers. I am Fatoumata Kasama. I come from the Gambia. My question is, climate change affects women and girls, especially those from low-income families, and people are dying. Mm-hmm. People go to bed without food. Mm-hmm. Women are having serious issues, a lot of maternal death. Mm-hmm. And within my network in the Gambia, I did not hear anybody talking about planetary health. I came to Germany in March. I only learned about planetary health in July. Last week, I attended a summer school at Wolfsburg University on planetary health. And I find this topic very interesting. I'm a health worker. I've been in the health system for 10 years, practicing as a nurse. And so the issue is, I believe the planetary health movement or awareness, it's more in the Europe. People in Africa don't have the knowledge, especially those who can be the change makers, either those young people in the civil society organizations or health workers. And then my question is, as the initiators of the planetary health movement, what are you guys doing or what strategies do you have to involve women and children from developing countries? We've had people saying Oprah, Drogba, or other celebrities. How about people at the bottom line who have no access to internet or even electricity? What strategies are you putting in place to raise awareness or educate them? Because at the end of the day, climate change affects them more than any other person. Thank you.
Mira, we're running out of time, yes. So each one of us can have one final thought. Maybe we start with you, and then Rosamund, Johan, and
sure. Try to. I'm going to run through really quickly. So on sports, there's some really awesome stuff happening in Australia. The Australian cricket captain has started an initiative called Cricket for Climate. He's the most trusted messenger in Australia. Definitely look at that. Drogba was in this room before. There was a big panel on sports. I didn't see climate as the priority there. So I did tweet about it. And I think I agree, we need sports people to talk about it more. Loyal Nationals in the UK correspond with the group that I mentioned called the Angry in Germany. Yes, we are working on connecting with those people, but we have to find those trusted messengers in the middle. So we try to have open calls where we invite community-based organizations, whether that's churches, whether that's sports clubs, whether that's schools or whatever, to work with us, and we help them to communicate more effectively with those people. Healthcare influencers, yes, we do train healthcare workers. We'd love to do much more of that, so please get in touch. The floods are driven by climate change, 100%. But what you can do as healthcare workers is talk to people who are affected about how they can build their local resilience. There are a lot of things happening there now. I have family in the northern part of Sindh where the flooding is really bad. You know, skin diseases, there isn't resilient housing for people. There's just a lot you can do to help them build resilience without them being responsible for the crisis. And on XR, I think that's a very big debate and discussion that we can have. I think they have shifted the terms of the debate, but they also create frustration and they do put people off sometimes. So I think it's complicated. They have an important role, but also there are questions about it. So we could talk about that another time. Thanks.
I think there is enough research out there. I think there's 70,000 plus papers about air pollution and the impact on health. I think it would help. It would help if there are, you mentioned the word, the diversity, but the people who are most impacted, they are not really part of the decision making. And I think when it comes to air, I think someone mentioned food, but how I always say to people is, you know, you can survive 2 weeks without food, 2 days without water, but 2 minutes without air. And I think it's about being honest, and it's about going up against those messages which are false. Apparently in the UK, when I talk, I'm not medically qualified. I mean, my background is from psychology, but people listen. And I think it's about having an authentic voice. And sometimes, my daughter, as much as there is division, and I looked at that graph which you put, but she's one person for whatever reason, when her face comes up on the telly or whatever, everyone, despite their anger, despite their division, they go, oh, that girl, that child. So you can cut through to people, but it's about being honest. And I'll go back to the health workers. Please use your influence. Please use your power. And please speak truthfully to people and let them know what happens. If we do nothing, people will continue to die, and it will be those who are most marginalized, who are not part of it. So I actually urge you to continue. At times it seems bleak, but you can persuade people, and COVID showed us people do care about their health. They went to extraordinary lengths. People did things that we never, ever imagined. And as we know, the waiting lists all over the world are getting longer with all sorts of NCDs, and a lot of it is linked to air pollution. Research is now out that shows that lung cancer, for the first time, it is linked to air pollution amongst non-smokers. So we need to keep going, please. Thank you very much for having me.
Thank you, Rosamund. And before you answer, Johan, after a lot of diagnostic clarity, I would love to hear your words of hope. What can we look forward in the COP in Egypt?
Yeah, thanks, Eckhart. Well, unfortunately, there's actually not so much light in the COP27 panel, I'm afraid. But let me at least point to something. And just to start then, a few reflections on these really rich questions. Just to combine this question of Extinction Rebellion and Stop Oil, let's say the real barricade activists with the really important work that Amira has presented here on the segments in society. We have quite a lot of empirical evidence showing that in any population, there is a normal distribution with, you know, a few percentage, in many countries, actually very, very small marginal number of climate denialists. In Europe, it's a very minuscule percentage, actually. And in the other end, you have a quite significant 10 to 20% population, which are the, you know, the most aware, the most engaged, the activists, the barricade, the voices that are really at the front line. My view is that they play a really important role, but they will never be the solution. You need them out there to put the flag, the red line in the sand. But for us to succeed in solving the climate crisis, we need this, as has been pointed out by so many of you, to be the story of success, of responsibility, of health, of security. And it can only be succeeded if it becomes the mainstream story, the story that finance ministers, that business leaders, that, you know, society at large steps on board on. And we have quite a lot of evidence that that is the path forward, because as was shown, 60 to 80% of populations are actually willing to step up if they can see the benefits from that transition. So going then to COP27 and Sharm el-Sheikh, well, we will be meeting there in a situation where Pakistan and Bangladesh and Kenya and Somalia and Ethiopia will be coming with very deep concerns of being hit very hard of climate impact and wanting compensation for loss and damage. Loss and damage will be the big item at COP27. The whole adaptation agenda and the need to sort out this question of compensation for climate impacts caused primarily by the long history of emissions in the wealthier part of the world. This is a very, very challenging agenda, as you all know. So I hope that Sharm el-Sheikh will be a point where we stop debating the need to decarbonize the world economy. We need to follow through on the pledges made in Glasgow on delivering the pathway towards cutting emissions by half every decade, while at the same time putting money on the table from the rich parts of the world, not primarily to compensate for loss and damage, recognizing this agenda, yes, but to help invest in pathways towards a healthy, sustainable and resilient energy future, which ticks off air pollution, but also ticks off energy security. I think that's what has to happen at Sharm el-Sheikh.
So we've come a long way in these 19 minutes from a very personal story of Rosamund, of the Healthy Planet, Healthy People narrative, to Ronaldo, to COP27, to loss and damages, and the question of climate justice. If we're seeing how many people are suffering now, not only always giving this narrative, oh yes, in the future something bad can happen, it's happening now, it's not happening anywhere. It's that's what I like about the Lancet Climate Countdown. Everyone is being touched. No one remains untouched. So this is very important to get across. Oh, yeah, there are some activists in front of the window. I'm not quite sure what they want, but these are the finishing words anyway. And my answer to you, that activism is not helpful, and we need above all, we need a better word for activism, because there are some people. We need better words for people like you and me and others who are trying to use their influence in public, behind the scenes, towards politicians to keep up with democracy. And the more aggressive the activists become, the more easier the right-wing parties flourish and they cherish the division in society. So I want to end with a challenge for every one of you that I end every presentation with. If you want to, you can check our website. It's only in German, but I, after this World Health Summit, I will translate it to English, and Deepal does a good job. You will find a video where Rosamund is part, where Johan is part, and the spiritual rector is climate outreach. So this winning narrative of health is still to be broadened. And one really cognitive dissonance is the concept of irreversibility. And Johan, I want to thank you for your work on this, because I think this is one of the biggest challenges to the way human minds work. They think if there's a danger, I can run away, I have my stress hormones. But in the climate crisis, there's no place where you can run to globally. And we have no learning story, because after the tipping points, there will be no technical solution, like some people always suggest. Oh yeah, we'll find something that will, like a Hoover, remove all the carbon dioxide, which is nonsense. So one very simple story that I want to offer you is, when people don't understand the concept of irreversibility, ask them if they've ever cooked an egg. Most people have. And an egg transforms irreversibly at 42 degrees. If you cook an egg, it changes its protein. And if the water cools down, it will never come back to life again. A boiled egg never becomes life again. So it's very important to have images that click to normal everyday life and illustrate that we are at tipping points. And the social tipping points that Ilona Otto from the PIG pointed out in a very important paper are the financial sector, the media, everyday life. So each one of you after the session should feel like a change agent, herself, himself. Who is the most powerful person you can talk to about this session? And if every one of you does this, and every one of the panelists thinks, well, this is a story that I want to keep on telling, try to use really your power, because to my knowledge, this is the only thing that really helps against despair and frustration, to be self-sufficient and not stay selfish, but become more in common orientated. Thank you very much.